It's great to see such a diverse audience, but I think at least 50% women, and which we'd expect for an event like today. The organizers asked me to talk a little bit about my own journey, and I would like to take you back to 20 years ago today, which is probably January of 1994, and I was one of the startup team for a company called Electric Classifieds, and one of our proof of concept companies or divisions was called Match.com. And I was in charge of bringing Match.com to the market. Believe it or not, back in 1994, there were dire predictions on the internet about only 20% of internet users were women. Can you believe that? Of course, that changed very quickly. And I was hired in part because I was a woman, and I had a marketing background that I got from Clorox, and it was felt that if we were going to address the very sleazy 900 number personals market, remember that? Some of you don't, I'm sure, which is good, that we needed to have a well-lit, friendly approach to it, and a woman's touch was considered to be important to that. I also think that a couple of things are really important. So how many of you have ever done any sort of online dating? And this question is a lot of you, and probably all of you know someone who has, right? Have you ever answered the question, what is your weight? No, that's because of me. The point was is that even though Match.com, like any other dating service, isn't just for women, the idea was that you know, people would rather know body type, or women certainly would be more comfortable with sharing their body type. I was also part of and invented the business model for online dating that has stood up almost all the way until now, which is a membership model. I had done some work at AAA prior to coming to Match.com. I knew that membership brought it privilege and prestige, and that asking men and women to spend a dime or 25 cents to contact other people would not be something that women would like. So there you go. But here's the deal. We sold Match.com in 1998 for less than $10 million. And I got a sum total, which is why I still have to do Airbnb to subsidize my life. We sold it for a sum total of about $7 million, and I got about a couple hundred thousand dollars, which to my then husband, who was risk averse, he was very happy to get a couple hundred thousand, and we furnished our house and all of that. But obviously, what happened? Why didn't I get more? I learned today that Match.com is one of only a handful of brands, including eBay, for example, that are still around and leading their industry 20 years later. Yet, I didn't get too much for it, and I didn't get to stay on the team or see it through. And part of that is very much because I was a woman. I don't think that I had the confidence, or nor did I have people around me saying, you can do it. We sold it, and nobody suggested that I could lead the team and make it happen. When I left Match.com, and part of it is I didn't want to move to Texas, I had some good job offers, but not the kind of offers I think that you would expect. And again, I think that was because I was a woman. And finally, I was not good about asking for help. And this is related to the confidence that women have or don't have. When you don't have confidence, you don't ask for help because you don't want to share that vulnerability. And that is one reason why it didn't work out for me. Now, there's a good side to the story. 10 years later, I'm running another startup, actually a nonprofit. Perhaps you know TRUSTe, the privacy solutions provider. And we were organized as a nonprofit. I knew the privacy issues were going to get bigger, and boy, have they. And this time around, I did lead a management and investor buyout of the nonprofit assets to take TRUSTe from nonprofit to for-profit. So I got my better deal, and it happened. I think it's good for TRUSTe and good for all of us, and certainly good for me. So I learned my lesson. I am so excited to be here tonight. These ladies are phenomenal. They are confident. Their role as female entrepreneurs is increasingly becoming something to watch. They are role models, if not to their teams, certainly to each other. And they are disruptors. They are looking at things and trying to figure out and deliver ways to do them better. And finally, and I'm so impressed with this, they are young. I mean, this is women under 30. And I'm so excited to speak with them today, and we'll get started. So today what we're going to do is, I've got a bunch of questions, but we're going to really leave it to them to kind of move through it. The first thing is give them a chance to introduce themselves and describe their journey to being a startup founder, and especially their aha moment. So I'll start with Brienne.
Hi, can everyone hear us okay? My name is Brienne Ghafourifar, and I'm the co-founder of Entefy. We're a communications startup tackling the world of harmonizing your digital interactions, so all the different places that you go to in your life to communicate and interact with people and things, we're bringing into one interface that works on every device. And we started the company, I started it with my brother and co-founder who's here in the audience. Can you raise your hand? Alston? Yeah, Alston. He's also happens to be my biggest role model. But beside that, we started the company together, and we saw a big consumer pain point for what we were trying to build. And I was an econ major, he's a politics major, and they say that together we can rule a nation. So I feel fortunate to be on this journey with him.
I'm Lisa Falzone. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Revel Systems, and we do iPad point of sale for high volume single store locations and chains and franchises. My aha moment was really when we found, my co-founder and I, we found the idea, and that really the idea was born out of doing an ordering app, trying to integrate into legacy point of sale, and we just, I had done a lot of businesses before, and I had never seen such a pain point with point of sale, and just that people just hated their point of sale systems. And so with that realization that it was such a huge problem for people and also a huge problem from a developer standpoint, we just saw such a huge opportunity. And so that's when I just said, this is the one, this is the idea that is gonna revolutionize the world.
All right.
I'm Alex Meliones. I'm co-founder of BitWall. We do micropayments for digital publishers. So instead of paying a subscription model, we allow you to pay for one article that you want to read rather than paying for a whole bunch of articles that you might not be interested in. I started the company with my brother as well. We compete in a lot of hackathons throughout the Bay Area, and we use that as kind of an A/B testing to figure out different business models, to figure out what the biggest market is we could tackle, where there's going to be some good investor appetite, and what we're gonna be passionate about. We ended up winning a hackathon with BitWall, and within the first 24 hours, we had our first product, we had our first investor, and our first customer.
Wow. Nancy.
Hi, everyone. My name is Nancy Liu. I am the CEO and co-founder of Implug. At Implug, we build the open platform software for you to show any kind of content on digital display. So our customers are shopping malls, hotels, restaurants that have displays where you can use your mobile phone to interact with it. You'll see them throughout the Bay Area. So if you can tweet at a display at the restaurant, that's us making the software happen. And our aha moment, and the reason we started this company, was actually first for the team. I met my co-founder who basically said, I dropped out of MIT, became from doing computer science, made millions of dollars playing online poker, and then I met my other co-founder who built two of the top 10 most downloaded education apps in the App Store while he was a sophomore in college, and we're like, hey, you guys are pretty smart, let's start the company. But really, the aha moment for our business model and what we're doing is when we were building the software for displays, and we were just doing it for ourselves. We said, how cool would it be if, like, our local restaurant, we could, like, tweet photos and we can talk smack to each other about, like, the sports game that's happening on the other display. So we started building it. And then when the restaurant themselves said, hey, how much do we pay for that software? We're like, oh my gosh, we can charge for this. So that was kind of our aha moment.
Hi, my name is Yunha. I'm a co-founder and CEO of Locket. Locket is an Android lock screen company. So we have this lock screen that currently is just, you know, blue screen, and we replace that screen with the contextually relevant content. So it could be anything from, you know, hey, there will be an earthquake in your area, to anything from there's a missing Malaysian airplane from CNN, or to Justin Bieber is going to jail from TMZ. So that's what we do. And our aha moment was I was working at an investment bank, and that was my first job out of college. And eighth month into it, I wasn't really liking it. And so I was looking at some business models, and the idea of like, hey, we're looking at the lock screen 110 times on average per day, and you know, if you multiply that by the number of Android users, which is 80 million in the US, that's 10.8 billion glances on the lock screen every single day. And we were thinking that there must be something else other than just a blank screen. So that's how I started with my co-founder, who's my best friend from my high school and college.
So let me ask you this. Do you think you were driven to be an entrepreneur because you want to be an entrepreneur, or was it for you that you saw a market need or a product need that you thought you could fill? Let's start with Yunnan.
For me, I didn't want to be an entrepreneur. When we were doing this, we didn't think of ourselves as an entrepreneur. And we didn't realize that we were starting a company either. So we moved into a two-bedroom apartment thinking that we were working on this project. And we're working on this project at an apartment because we don't have money. So it was more like project-based and also kind of mixed with the feeling of I don't like my current job of investment banking. So that's how.
Well, let's go quickly. Nancy, want to be an entrepreneur, or you just saw the product need?
Totally accidental. Grew up on a farm in Colorado. My dad built tractors, so I was building things. And the reason I decided, hey, I should maybe just be an entrepreneur is starting my freshman year when I was basically building these random stuff on the side. I made a lot more money selling these basic apps on the side than my parents had made in their salary. So I was like, all right, I probably should just do this full time.
I always wanted to, and always knew it was probably going to be with my brother. So it was pretty cool to see it happen.
I want to come back to the co-founder thing. Lisa?
Yeah, I wanted to be an entrepreneur and start my own business because I didn't want to work for anyone else.
Okay. That sounds good. And
I definitely was entrepreneurial. I've been like that throughout my entire life. But Entefy came around, and I realized that there was a big consumer pain point that could use a solution that kind of revolutionizes the world of communications. And that's when I realized that I wanted to be really an entrepreneur.
So did you all notice they all have co-founders? If you could just tell us who your co-founder is, if they're here. One of you did that. I think Alex, Brienne did.
Yeah.
Introduce your brother.
That's awesome.
Think Alex's brother is here. was that important to give you the confidence to start your company?
Actually, we were just talking about this in the back that having a co-founder, it's all about trust. And if that person's your brother, or if it's your parent, or if it's your sibling of some kind, or your distant grandmother or a stranger you met in college, it doesn't really matter. But I think that bond is really important, and it's someone you're tied to for a long time, so you better choose the right person. And it's about complementary skill sets, so I think my brother and I have that for sure.
And Alex?
I think having my brother as my co-founder has definitely been very helpful because he's someone that I look up to a lot, and then having him encourage me every day really makes me feel like empowered as an entrepreneur.
Anybody else want to talk about?
It's okay to start companies without your brother as well. I started my, before Implug, I started a biotech company. I had met my co-founder at a bar. Literally, and I was like, I was going through my Indian phase where I like Indian guys. It was in Colorado. He was the only guy, Indian guy at the bar.
Now pretend your dating life.
Basically, I pointed him out to my friend. My friend's like, oh, he's actually a famous biochemist. And I was like, what? No way. So immediately, I had no shame. I was like, let's start talking. It was midnight, and then 8 a.m. The next day, we started working together on basically building a product. So you can meet people at a bar too, and they can be talking.
So, as the audience probably knows, women are still, despite these women up here, a small percentage of entrepreneurs. And the media often says it's because women don't know how to code. Now, I think Alex knows how to code.
Yeah, I was actually going to say my brother actually told me, anytime you've told me you can't do something, you've shown me that you can do it. And that's how it was with coding, where I didn't know, and then he really inspired me to learn, and now I can do things that I just never imagined that I could ever build on my own.
Yeah, I think the media wants to make you think that you can't start a company unless you know how to code. And I remember thinking, when I went to college, that I couldn't start a company, and so I just didn't even think about becoming an entrepreneur. And then you kind of realize that there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of really powerful entrepreneurs and really a lot of great entrepreneurs that have never coded. So I would not let that prevent.
And so given that for those of you who don't have a technical background or didn't feel that you fit that mold, what did you do to compensate for that?
You look hard for somebody that can code
for you.
Or sometimes, for me, I have two co-founders, and both of them can code. And one guy is my best friend from high school and college. So
okay.
We knew going in
almost
that,
like a brother.
Yeah, but we knew that like it would be low cost business because we didn't have to hire a developer. The third guy, we looked for him. For somebody that can code without getting paid and getting paid with equity. So that's like one of the things that we did.
Yeah, no, that's a good thing. Okay, so let's talk about the woman thing. Let's just, all those questions you could ask to a guy, I think, just as easily. So I asked this question, is it an advantage or a disadvantage or both to being a woman? And you know what the answer was? Both. Almost all of them said both. So who wants to go first?
I can go first. So I think I've definitely noticed both. And I would have to say, I think all of this is a matter of perspective. So understanding who you are and what your strengths are and what you're doing for the world, it comes first. And then all the other biases that society has, you know, are secondary. And you can't let them prevent you from doing what you need to do. But, you know, I would say being a woman in the positive side, it's allowed me to kind of build a network of strong women around me that can, you know, be helpful and help Entefy grow and, you know, help me grow as well along the journey. And then on the negatives, there's always, you know, biases. And whether it's age or, you know, race or just, you know, gender, there's always going to be something. So I think you have to use it as a motivating factor to succeed.
Alex?
I would say that anyone who's ever made me feel bad or that I couldn't do anything because I was a girl has also made me feel stronger and more, I need to prove you wrong that I'm going to do this and I'm going to show you that if you don't think that I could be an entrepreneur or start this company because I'm a female or made me feel bad about it, then I'm going to show you that I can and it's going to be 10 times better than I thought it was before because now I'm empowered.
Nice.
There's an opportunity, too, for a lot of women entrepreneurs because there's so many resources coming out. And whenever I go to events, for example, I was at one in Italy where I was paid several thousand dollars to be on a panel with the Prime Minister of Italy, Prime Minister of Finland, CEO of New York Times, and CEO of Chrysler. And they asked me because I think they realized they can't just have a panel of 50-year-old white dudes. I hit the minority one. I hit the age. And,
right.
You know, so there's that benefit.
Come on. Somebody's got to have a bad story. Like one time where they fell. Lisa? No?
Well, I think as far as a disadvantage for being a woman?
Yeah, or one instance where
I've
it
never
just
been
wasn't
a man, so it's hard for me to judge. but I think that it's definitely I think it's a disadvantage just because I think people on this panel and other women entrepreneurs are really pushing the whole, you know, all of women forward. I think also it's really a disadvantage when you go to raise money just because, and not really as much of a fall against the investors, but just because investors like to invest in people that are like themselves or
4% of venture capital.
Yeah. Right.
Venture capitalists are women, 4%.
So, right, so they like to invest in people that are like themselves, and then they like to invest in people that they've seen start a company and made it into a multi-billion-dollar company. And there's like not very many women that have done that, if any, almost. And so because of those two factors, they are already biased against you. And so whether
then the tech thing,
right? Mm-hmm. And so whether it's spoken or it's not spoken, it's just their general
right.
bias. So yeah.
So I told them I was going to do a lightning round, okay? And this I was going to go and ask them. Do you feel questions, or have you ever felt? Have you ever felt like an imposter? Raise hands, or not. Okay, you know what that means? The imposter theorem is very many women, when they're in roles like a CEO or a founder or whatever, feel like they don't belong. Have you ever felt that you have no role models? Okay.
In women or in general?
Just general.
Oh, I take that back.
Have you ever felt that you aren't being listened to? Right. Have you ever felt sort of sexually objectified? Okay. And have you ever felt the expectation that you're supposed to be nice and soft, not assertive and, yeah, okay. Any others for the audience? These are the things that most women in business and certainly most entrepreneurs often feel, that they're not listened to, they're marginalized or looked at, objectified in some way, and that they lack role models. Any of you want to talk about where you raise your hand? You want?
I think maybe one thing that related to this is like it's coming from internalization. Like sometimes I go to work and I'm just kind of cranky that day, and like something happens, and like you know maybe I bring up a hard subject, and I'm questioning myself: am I being too bitchy today? Like if I am too bold or too harsh or too strong. If it was a guy, then I would be okay. Like you know I'm charismatic and you know I'm determined. But since I'm a girl, I kind of wonder like, am I being bitchy here, or am I being you know am I PMSing?
So
a lot of times it's like it's more like self-questioning more so than somebody else telling me, hey, you know you're being bitchy today. So I think it's more so like how you look at yourself as a woman and also how you think is the right thing to do.
Nancy, did you want to comment?
Any of them? I think I felt it through, like especially when I was fundraising, I would notice if I was going to go and pitch to an angel investor that was older, I'd catch myself, I'd be wearing a suit, I'd be wearing all black, I'd put my hair back, I'd wear no makeup, and I would have to consciously think about this. And I also know going into a meeting, I have way less time than a male counterpart to make an impression. There are times when I walked in, I have four male co-founders, and when I took one of them into, like immediately the investors would just assume my male co-founder was the CEO and not me. And so, yes, this happens all the time. It still happens.
What about with your employees? Do you ever feel like they're not...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Go for it.
Well, again, I've never been a man, so I don't have anything to compare it to, but I feel like, you know, men aren't used to... I think throughout childhood, like, you're never used to being beaten up by a woman. Like it just doesn't. I mean, I know I'm not beating people up, but I'm just saying that if you have to, you know, tell someone, you know, this is not okay, or this is like, you know, you have to demote someone or you have to fire someone. I mean, that you know, that it's not normal. So we weren't really brought up that way. I find it different.
Yeah. Have any of you ever cried at work?
Yes.
I definitely cry.
Yeah.
How do the men react to that?
Very gently. They like slide a coffee across the desk.
I've seen guys cry at work.
That's very good, human. Really?
You know, they just can't take the stress. But one of the things, that I was actually going to mention really fast is that I think, to your point actually, which was the thing around, you know, women aren't always perceived as being, I'm going to use the word hard ass, sorry to say that on stage, but they're not necessarily perceived as being that, whereas men in powerful positions often can be. So, you know, there's a difference between, you know, having that time of month and then just being really strict and really performance-based. Mm-hmm. And I think often being a nice woman is always, you know, often misinterpreted to be overly friendly or not, you know, being taken seriously. And I think that's a really hard thing to
manage. And
being
assertive is being a bitch or too aggressive.
Exactly.
Yeah,
right. Exactly. You're either too nice or too on the other side.
Yeah, I feel it. So what do you guys feel when you see movies or shows? You know, how many of you have seen Silicon Valley? I think it was a series on HBO. The media portrays all the entrepreneurs were guys. Almost all of them wore hoodies. Nobody is wearing a hoodie here. How do you feel about it?
In this ecosystem and that with this atmosphere of people around me that I've surrounded myself with, I'd be a little disheartened to start a company where I wouldn't feel like it is what it is. It just paints this perspective that it's just not accurate. I mean, I've never gone out to all these parties that they go to, like they're going nuts all the time on that show. And I mean, if I had a reality show, it'd be so boring. It would just be me and my computer for a lot of hours.
I'll be honest, I have a hoodie, and I do wear it, and I it's like the most comfortable thing, but at the same time, I'm not going to walk down Wall Street with it, so I think there's a balance here. I like to be comfortable. Phil is wearing a hoodie, Entefy hoodie right now. It's beautiful fabric, and it, you know, that, how else are you going to work 24 hours a day?
Like, yeah, I know. The point is the media depiction of tech entrepreneurs is, and I think the audience probably knows that more women start businesses, maybe not venture-backed businesses, than men in our country, and that's a response to all kinds of things. So women have gotten a bad rap in the past for not helping each other, for not extending a hand, not being there for other women. Can you guys comment on whether or not that's changed?
I definitely have heard that from other female founders, and so actually for our company, we take active steps to make sure that we are actively helping women entrepreneurs. So at Impleg, our teammates, you know, they're so used to seeing women leading things because, you know, I'm the female CEO. Our CTO is female, and she leads an engineering team of 12 dudes, which is kind of funny. And then our head of sales is also female. So the three, top titles at our company are all female. So we actually host every quarter this Women's Summit in Los Angeles, and we bring on other very successful female entrepreneurs, and we invite the startup community to get involved, because I think myself, I have heard that from other female founders. It's like, oh my gosh, like, I don't feel like other female founders are helping each other out. So we take active steps to actually do that, and I think that's the only way to change it, is each of us having to take that step and be proactive about it.
Yeah, I think it's important to not see other women as competitors or any of that, because I think that's ridiculous and super sad. But to really help also other women founders. On the flip side, I also think, though, as far as a boss, I think it's really important to not like promote people just because of their gender. Sure. Either way. I think it's important just to really take that out of the equation and just like judge people based off their results. So.
And what about men? Do you feel that there are men who are actively either not showing any sort of bias or promoting women as entrepreneurs or your businesses?
I think men are actually really impressing me. I mean, I will say, I think this is a, you know, it's a bit of a trend right now, and it's on the rise, just talking about women in tech and women in STEM. And I'm always very impressed when I see men trying to take an effort in that world, because I think as long as people have the equal opportunity, you know, it's a matter of what you do with it. And we just talked about this earlier. Mm-hmm. But I see it more and more, and I think that's amazing. And I think women should absolutely do the same thing, to your point.
Well, let's talk about the most important kind of help. Oftentimes that's funding, getting that first big check. And all of you guys have raised some money, right, for your companies? So anybody want to share how that went and sort of challenges and learnings?
I can share a story on that if everybody's interested in hearing it. I'll try to be fast. Funding for me, it comes up a lot in conversation, and honestly, it's one of my favorite things to do. It's hard as heck. It's not easy. Nobody says that it will be, but the day that someone looks at you in the eye and they give you this little paper, and some people confuse that for a check when really it's an I believe in you slip. And I think that's one of the most beautiful moments when people see your vision in the same way you do and they support it. And raising capital, it's very exciting. And we had a bit of an interesting story here as a company. When I was 17, we had raised a little bit of capital, and then we were building product. And then one of our team members came to us and said, hey, Brienne, if you raise $1 million in the next 2 weeks, you'll become the youngest college graduate in the world to raise $1 million in funding. And I would be 18. And I said, well, that's really nice. Why are you telling me this 2 weeks before, you know, my birthday? So in 8 days, our team put it full force, and we raised that million, and we hit our goal. And honestly, it came down to the people that support you and the people that believe in you, whether you're a woman or whether you're young or whether you're a guy. It really doesn't matter. But you have to surround yourself with those people that will help you succeed. And that comes from everywhere. And I think that was our biggest lesson. And we think that the people that supported us, those are the people we owe it to.
Yunha, I know you had a story too.
Oh yeah, so the first initial investors that we raised from were all guys, but one of our investors is Tara Banks, and she really promotes female entrepreneurship. And we didn't directly talk about I'm investing in you because you're female, but I wonder if that's one of the reasons.
Oh,
and
sure.
The kind of help she's been providing has been tremendous.
Yeah. I've raised three rounds of funding, and I've learned something different every single time.
Do tell.
But I think for the last one, I really got like the trick down, I figured out how to hack the funding system. I feel like kind of.
Is that what you mean?
What? No, hacking is in a good way. No, but anyway, For me, like it was really helpful to get other people that were like promoting, like that would go out and like actually like build me as the CEO up, so that people that like, you do have to like notice the gender biases, but then if you get kind of older men promoting you, then they build you up, and then you walk in, and then you close.
Yeah.
And so I noticed that was like a really good way to deal with people's psychology, and then getting that kind of bidding war also going was helpful for me.
And usually when you're a CEO, you're also the chief salesperson. So similar, or were there some differences in that? Lisa, maybe, or?
I think your number one job is a salesperson.
Yeah, we want to raise you money. And Alex?
Yeah. I'm not CEO, but
okay.
I do a lot of sales. I think every founder, you wear every single hat no matter what, and you just adapt to it.
I would say your role as a CEO at the very early stages is all sales, whether you're selling to somebody trying to convince them to join you. When I was in college building my biotech company, I was an undergrad trying to convince PhD students to join my company, and that was like a total sales process. And then when we started InPlug in Los Angeles, I had never spent more than 2 days in Los Angeles before that. So I realized it was all a numbers game in terms of finding investors. I would take the middle seat on airplanes so I could talk to the people next to me. I would try to meet people anywhere and everywhere, literally. And it's like, if I talk to 100 people, 50% of them will maybe respond to my email, 10% might take an email, and 1% might be, the one person might be relevant and turn into an investor. And that very much is like a sales funnel.
Yeah,
exactly.
I met my first investor at a coffee shop, just like randomly, like he was getting coffee.
Oh, yeah. Serendipity is still a really important thing, no matter what.
I also think it's important just to talk to everyone. When you go to events, just make a point to be actually talking. And I wasn't really good at that in the beginning because it's not comfortable to just introduce yourself and start talking to people. But it helps so much because it builds your network. You never know who they're going to think in your mind, like, oh, this is a great person for you to meet. And that's how we've met a lot of our just key business contacts.
I think the network actually is really important. And sometimes, people say, well, what if I don't have a network? Well, there's always a network, even especially we're in the Silicon Valley. But even in the rest of the world, I mean, it doesn't just start necessarily from an investor per se. It could start from vendors. You know, it could start from your bank. It could start from your, friend that's runs like a CPA firm. You know, it could start from all of these places. And the more you start accumulating these contacts, they're going to help you. If they love what you're doing and they see you persevering, they're going to be helpful to you. And I think that's where it all starts.
Yeah, I think there's more evidence that having a network, having a co-founder are really important things in a sales mentality to success. So you guys are doing great. So let's talk now. You've raised money. You have the idea, aha moment. You've got your co-founder. You've raised some money. You've done some development. You have maybe some products. And now you have employees and a company and all of that. So first of all, you can anticipate a lot of things. Can you, any of you, share something that surprised you, that you didn't anticipate, and maybe it was an obstacle, or maybe it was a good thing, maybe it was a bad thing, just something that surprised you that you wouldn't have known going into it? And I think, Nancy, you were saying, oh, yeah, okay.
HR. I never learned about HR when I was in school. And one of the majors I studied was business. It's something that I totally took for granted, did not really anticipate. I mean, for the first year, up until we had up to 20 employees, I was every month, like personally, like sending out the checks, electronic checks to everyone. And there would be months, like a week into the month, and one of my teammates would come to me and be like, hey, did you like send out the check? Yeah, I didn't receive it. I'd be like, oh crap, I forgot to do that. And so figuring out the HR system was really important and something we had to be very conscious of for legal implications, because you can fire people in the wrong way if you don't take certain steps, depending on the type of employee they are. So those are things I really had to be thoughtful of, and actually hiring an HR company, either hiring HR manager to do that or outsourcing it, which we do, outsourcing it to a company. And the cost associated with HR is beyond what I ever expected.
So when I started, when I wanted to start a company, I thought it would be really hard. I thought product, creating a product would be really hard. I thought selling the product would be really hard. I thought raising money would be really hard. But by far, the thing that I totally underestimated and has been the hardest thing is building the team, mm-hmm. and the people. And that is, to me, the most important thing and also the most challenging thing. And that is something I completely underestimated.
And everybody is nodding. Okay, Yuna.
I guess, yeah, like for me, I thought like building the team is okay, but I think sustaining that, the morale, and making sure every day they come into work excited is hard.
I was going to ask a question actually about culture. Did you go into your company saying, I want it to have this kind of culture?
No, I did not. I haven't worked at other companies other than, you know, McKinsey or Jefferies, which was an investment bank, where like we don't really have a culture because we are not at the same office all the time. So I guess I didn't think about that, but like after 6 months, after we launched a product and after we had some more time to think about it, we realized how important that is, because for some people that might be the only reason that, you know, that person's like really working hard. It might not be the idea or yeah, you know, the business, but it might be the team.
Did anybody else kind of think about having culture?
So I didn't think about having a culture, but it kind of hit me in the head that I needed to think about a culture. Because it really hit me after we started scaling after our Series B round of financing, because we grew to like 100 people, and I had from 30 to 100 people, and I hadn't.
After 50, you don't know everybody's name. That's.
I hadn't. Yeah. Well, I hadn't thought about everyone uses the word culture, and I always thought it was just this like kind of BS buzzword, and I was like, whatever. And but then I realized like absolutely how critical like defining your values and just like basic like fundamental values. Like one of our values is teamwork. One of our values is like be customer centric, thinking entrepreneurially. So we have like six values, and so I quickly defined that because I was realizing like the culture was going out of control, people weren't working on a team, and so quickly defined that and then put it in the structure so it's also part of like quarterly reviews, so like you're graded half on results but then also half on values, and so that it basically like forces it makes sure like those, that culture and those values are promoted throughout the company. But it was a nightmare before I defined them.
And Nancy and Alex then too.
Well, we were able to find our culture like kind of organically, because for the first year and a half, we worked out of a house in Bel Air, Los Angeles. So it was 13 people living in the house and 20 people total working out of the house.
Oh my goodness.
So everything was shared. Like we shared the food, we shared everything. And so our culture became naturally very family oriented. We knew everything that was going on in each other's lives. People would bring their day. I mean, because we lived together. I live with my co-founders and teammates. You know, you saw everything about them. And so as we then, of course, as we grew, you know, going to 35 people, we had to move into an office. So now we have an office, but we still kept the house, which has been this foundation of our culture, which is like we share everything, our life. You know, Implug is not just a job. It is your lifestyle. And that's very still.
Okay,
still.
So we'll get to the life balance question in a little bit. Do you think your companies have more diversity than other similarly sized tech companies because you're women, or diversity of a different kind? You're also all very young. So what can you say about diversity?
I think it depends on what kind of roles you have in your company. For us, aside from me, everyone is engineer. I have not met a single, aside from one person, I haven't really interviewed any female engineers. And it's super hard.
Awful.
It's like a unicorn finding on a female engineer. So I think it really depends on the job functions. If you're a sales company, then maybe you have more female people than if you are just a core engineering team.
So you haven't interviewed any women for engineering?
Yeah. I tried to pitch to one person, but it wasn't more like interview.
Wow. Okay, Nancy, what about your company?
Oh, I would say we... Because I brought on board a bunch of people from Berkeley, which is where I went to school, and I think with Berkeley, you're just automatically very, like, I don't know, maybe a little bit more progressive than other parts of the country. And so with that, we have diversity, both ethnicity. We have gays, lesbians on our team that are very open, so very, very
open. How many of you have people over 40 on your teams?
None.
Okay.
Okay. Maybe not so much on age diversity.
Alex, what about your company?
Well, we're a team of four right now, and I would say besides Nick and I mean, I'm a female, he's a male, everyone else is very diverse, so it's cool. Everyone has a very, and we have Jerry, who's older of the group, and then I'm on the younger spectrum, and then George just graduated college recently, so it's very cool, very different backgrounds, everyone.
I'm actually really excited about my team because I'm no longer the youngest. I think someone beats me by a month, which I'm really happy about. But most of my team, it scales all over the age. And we have a philosophy that we're a high-performant family. That's how we kind of define who we are. And we're a team of courageous innovators. So we build things that should exist but don't. And in that, you find gems everywhere. I mean, you find them in college. You find them, you know, in different countries. You find them in different ages and at different gender levels and all that. So I think it's about finding people who want to work on your, you know, building a great vision.
Great. So that's all the good stuff. Lisa, can you tell me about a obstacle or something that you really had to overcome? And then I'm going to ask some other people. But
I think every day there's like 50 obstacles to overcome. So I don't know if I could think of just one, but I think there's just, I get asked this question a lot. I think there's just challenges in everything. Like, I think when you're building something out of nothing, you're just constantly challenged every day, and that's the exciting thing about it. And, you know, that's the scary thing about it, too. I think that you're also, you know, we're all creating innovative products, so we're creating industries that probably, you know, a lot of them haven't even existed before. And so you're out there, and you don't know what's going to happen, but that's also part of the thrill. So I think that there's just obstacles and challenges. I mean, in everything, building the product, building the team, raising money. I mean, everything is challenging.
And the to-do list gets long, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Anybody want to share a big obstacle?
There was this one time where we grew from 3 people to 15 people in a month and a half after we launched a product. And we realized that we were going to pivot, I think, a couple months later. So we, laid off half of our team. And as a first-time entrepreneur, that was really hard because, you know, I considered every one of the members as friends and you know, going to the coffee shop to let them know that they're not going to be here anymore was super hard, I think. That was my biggest challenge, I think.
And layoffs are hard, but firing somebody for poor performance is also really difficult. So... anybody want to talk about that? Or Nancy, do you have a story for us?
The first person we had to fire was about a year into building the company. Yeah, and we had no idea how to do it. I had not let go of someone before. And so we literally, as the 5 co-founders, we went and Googled, how do you fire someone? And we went and read some article about on like ehow.com, like about how to like fire somebody. And it was just like, we did it in totally the wrong way. You didn't need to do this. We were like, made such a big deal out of it. All of us were like, let's find a public space so that, you know, he can't like go crazy or something. And so we found like a coffee shop and we like spent an hour talking to him about like, you know, why, how we still really valued him, but it wasn't going to work out. I mean, it was like so over the top, you know, now there's like very systematic way we do it. And you know, we were surprised at how well people actually take it. Like, I think for most people, if you take the time to hire them, hopefully, you know that they're a logical person, and when you do let them go, they understand why, and they probably already saw it coming, and they really should. Otherwise, there's a communication barrier that happens.
I think if you hire correctly and you manage people correctly, then I think that's the case. But if you don't, which I've also been a part of, not hiring people correctly and not managing people correctly, it can get a little bloody, but yeah.
Well, hopefully not too bloody. Okay.
Not too bloody, not literally. But yeah.
So let's look at the future. I want to look at the future in a couple of different ways. One is, how long do you guys think you're going to stay with your current venture? And I know you're going to say what your investors want, but honestly, do you think you could, let me just ask you this way. Do you think it could be there 5 years from now? Do you think you'll be doing it five years from now? Everybody?
Absolutely. And well, I think it depends on what you're building too, right? And what the intention is for what you're building. In our case with Entefy, we're building something that we know once we release it, and when we release it, it's gonna be right. And that's, our promise to our customers, that this is a real need that people have. And because of that, we have to take it. We have to build enduring value. And I think that's different for every entrepreneur.
Yeah, okay. So what about 10 years?
One of the emails I sent to my team before the end of 2014, so we had, that was our 2-year mark, we had been building the company for 2 years. I also published this email that I wrote to my team on my blog, but basically in the email, it was titled The 17 Unicorns of 2014. Basically there were 17 companies that became worth over $1 billion in 2014, which is crazy to think about. Like how many, there's like tens of thousands of companies that start every year, and yet there's only 17 companies that hit $1 billion. And for our company, like our goal is very much to be an influential technology company and build it to be $1 billion. And so I did a number crunch on all the 17 companies, and the average amount of time it took them before they hit $1 billion was 9 years. So I sent it to my team. I was like, hey, just want you to know, like, yes, we've been building this for 2 years.
There's a big road.
It's not a sprint. It is a marathon. So be prepared for 9 years.
Yeah. So if it's a marathon,
sprinting a marathon.
It's a sprint. It's a
marathon sprint.
Yeah. No, it's tough. So think about 9 years, and do you think in those 9 years any of you will have children?
That's awkward.
I did not see that coming, actually.
Okay, now we're going to the territory of things you don't normally ask men. Yeah. So I have to apologize for that. But given the audience and all this, I think, and if I ever am moderating a panel with guys, I'll ask them this question, I promise you. Well, okay, so it's always, ad nauseum. How do you achieve work-life balance? Okay, honestly, do you think even now you have any sort of balance in your life in terms of taking care of your personal selves, spending time with friends, spending time with family, exercise, those are things that nourish you? Or are you saving that for later?
I think it's part of our culture. We work hard to make sure you have a work-life balance where you're not just sitting there, because you're going to burn out and then you're not going to be your 100% on Monday if you don't take the time to really do what makes you happy and find something that keeps you going. Whereas for me, it might be going on a hike, and for Nick, it's going to the gym, and everyone has this different thing that makes them just feel, because you want to hit your Monday and be ready to tackle it and be full force. And if you don't take time to take care of you, you can't get everything done.
How many of you worked over this past weekend? Yeah. Okay.
Can we switch that and say how many of you haven't worked on a weekend? That would be really interesting.
Oh, yeah. How many of you haven't worked on a weekend?
No, actually, I have a really, I have a very specific view on this particular question, because it gets asked all the time. Like, how do you manage life and work and things? And I honestly believe there's no such thing. I'm just going to say it out there. Feel free to yell and disagree. But I don't think there is such a thing. And one of my friends says it really well. He's a CEO of a gaming company. And he says that if you play life like a game, you're not working a day in your life. Which is very true, because I love what I do, and I don't do it because it's work or because I'm going to make money off of it or anything like that. I do it because I honestly love it. Like, I wake up in the morning and I want to go to Entefy. My doctor may disagree, but still, that's
a philosophy. I think that's a beautiful way of putting it. I love it. I think it's great.
Thanks.
So I agree.
Okay, completely.
Because if you look at work as an adventure, and this kind of fun adventure, then it's not. Like, you don't really have to have balance from, why have balance from your fun adventure?
Right.
Do you think that whole work-life balance thing is BS then?
I think
we're in the right position because none of us have kids. Whereas Fran, you had kids you were building your company. So I think unless we had kids, if I had kids, I would say yes, work-life balance. But I don't have kids.
Yeah, I don't think there's any such thing as perfect balance all the time.
Right.
I think for people like myself, it's more like work-life integration more so than work-life balance. And like, how do you make the alignment so that you feel like you're at home and also at work?
You're a group of entrepreneurs, you're all under 30, and it's fantastic. Do you think any of you would ever see yourself going to corporate America, even if that's Google or Facebook or Yahoo or Apple?
Yeah.
No.
Probably not, but I'm open to it. I'm kind of like, hey, if you know, like somebody wants to buy us for like $10 billion and I work for them, that's okay.
I think that's different than voluntarily
going. Well, that's a good exception.
I think it's what you want to be working on. Like if Google's working on something that you're very passionate about, I think that makes a lot of sense.
Do you ever think about, and I bet you all are going to say yes, about another area of tech that, man, if you weren't doing this, you'd be doing that, and what is it?
Well, my other company, I don't spend very much time, so I hired a professional management team to run the biotech company, but basically for that company I started in college, we developed a polymer that enables vaccines to survive without refrigeration so that you can then deliver vaccines to anywhere in the world, especially places that really need it. So that's kind of like my saving lives part of my life. And then Implug is like, let's build something huge and big and make a ton of money.
Yeah, okay.
Sometimes when I'm like, oh my God, point of sale is so intense because you're dealing with all these different pieces of hardware, you're dealing with networking, you're dealing with software, and it's the central nervous system, people's business. Sometimes I'm like, oh, it'd be great to do a picture, you know, a picture startup or...
just something really different.
Yeah, or like chocolate that makes people happy all the time.
Chocolate is always good, yeah.
And people are always happy when they eat chocolate.
Always chocolate. do you guys, just getting back into the personal a little bit, how much do you sleep?
Like full sleep? Because I'll sleep 3 hours
sleep.
And then wake up, do some stuff, sleep 3 hours,
stuff. All right.
I have a hard time falling asleep because I'm stressed all the time.
And if your
so
family
I don't sleep that much.
Yeah, I'm actually with you on both of those answers. And one of my friends who's in the audience tonight, she posted something on my Facebook wall of all places that had to be posted to say why you should get more sleep. And I think that was a really bad sign that said, hey, you should probably focus on that.
Right.
But I think our brains are moving so fast and we're constantly trying to look ahead for problems that could occur that it's really difficult to sleep.
Yeah, it's impossible to just shut it off at the end of the day. Yeah.
Okay,
you can
so
sleep when we're dead,
and,
right?
And, you know, I am almost fearing as I ask these questions that you're going to think less because they're women and they're saying they're not sleeping and they're showing a vulnerability. I hope we all feel more confident in them because they've sort of, they're in it, right? They're in it to win it. So just want to recognize that those questions can sometimes be unfair, but in the purpose of educating everybody else, I think it's okay. So now, is there questions from the audience? Okay. All right. And now I'm showing my age. Okay, great. Okay, here's the interesting one. What do you use instead of football metaphors? Or do you use sport metaphors with your teams?
I use sports metaphors all the time, but not football.
Okay, baseball, soccer?
So, I mean, I was a swimmer, so I use, like, like cheesy, like, Olympic races from, like, the 1990s.
Which
is what I grew up with, so
yeah, that's what you know. Anybody else?
We use soccer, actually, like the concept of a team. Like instead of having a bunch of 10x individuals, we like to say we're 10x team. So that's the difference between like Portugal and Germany sometimes when if you want to compare it to World Cup teams. So we use soccer.
Okay. Did anybody else want to bring up one?
I'll bring up superheroes all the time, like the Avengers,
superheroes.
And everyone will be a different superhero, and that's their power, and this power relates to something.
Yeah,
but it's exciting.
Okay, so speaking of metaphor, what's the hardest good old boy network to deal with? Is it sales? Is it engineers, investors, or some other?
I think the Silicon Valley VCs would be.
Silicon Valley as opposed to?
other places?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. So why particularly Silicon Valley VCs? Do you think they buy into the hype more, or?
No, I just think it's a little bit of an old boys club.
Yeah.
So
is it easier in Southern California?
That's great.
We came up here to raise money.
Yeah. Oh. Okay, when women founders are asked, is this XYZ, and I use some of these, a issue for you, the founders almost always say yes and have a related story. Does it bother you? If we ask some of these questions, like as a woman, if somebody says that, does it bother you? Or do you recognize that you just got to take it on?
I don't think that bothers me, but sometimes there's certain ways people phrase things that feels very isolating as a female founder, whereas being a founder is very isolating on its own because you're working these crazy hours and you're isolating yourself, and then you don't want to be isolated even more from that group.
Yeah, it does a little bit. Not that much, but a little bit, because I never really thought of myself as any different than, you know, as far as, like, work-wise, I never thought of myself as any different than a guy.
So somebody asked this, and maybe I'm not reading it right, so I'll just try and do it. What do you do if you don't code?
Everything else.
Everything else. Yeah.
You find awesome coders and run the rest of the business.
We recognize that. I keep on telling entrepreneurs, I totally think that this. When we talk with our engineering team, hey, can we like build XYZ? It's always like, yes, like given the right amount of time, you give them enough engineers, you can build anything you want. But that's not the part that's hard. The hard part is the business, building a sustainable business model and building something that people are willing to pay money for it. That's the hard part. It's not building some app. Anyone can build just an app. That's easy and put it on the app market. But it's another thing to actually build a business that will last 20 years.
Well, you have to build something that they want to pay for, but then convince them to pay for it too. So it's not just building it. You still have to convince them as well.
A lot of you are, your products, I almost all of you, deal with apps and mobile systems. And all of you are like under 30. Do you think that you guys saw or had an advantage with understanding mobile and social, especially just given your age, your ages?
Yes. Yeah.
But for us, like one of the apps that we're building right now that we're launching next month is for 17-year-old girls. So I'm kind of away from that age gap now. So I would go to Berkeley or Stanford and go to the campuses, and we would ask the 17-year-old girls.
So what kind of things did you draw upon to learn how to start a company?
Yeah, I went through a lot of books. One of the ones that sticks out in my mind when I was thinking about starting a company. I've been doing my company for 4 years, so it was a little, but it's book, Customer Development by Steve Blank. And I think it's really cool because I think it depicts one of the reasons why a lot of startups fail is because, you know, they end up for kind of what we were just talking about is that, you know, the question of what do you do if you're not a coder, but most of these startups, and he talks about in this book, it's like all about getting outside of your cubicle and going in and talking with the clients and talking with your prospects and figuring out what people actually want to buy and what people's pain points are, and then coming back and then coding versus like coding something, you know, something that is probably brilliant that you coded it, but like then you go to sell it, no one wants to buy it.
Sounds great. How about, did any of you do one of you did an accelerator?
Yeah, we actually went through two. So we went through Boost VC after we won the hackathon, and most recently we did AngelPad in New York. And both were amazing growth experiences. I mean, if you can apply and get into either, I grew so much through those because you just learn, and you're in this environment of people who are also starting companies, so you have this great network and foundation of people around you.
Let me ask this question. Have any of you talked about doing a deal with each other?
A deal?
Doing some deal with each other.
We're very close already.
Oh, all
I mean,
of
it's
guys?
Only been, yeah.
We're like BFFs. Okay.
We became BFFs when we got here.
I just realized, I think I went to your company.
Really?
And it's by San Carlos. Is it like by San Carlos?
Delayed reaction.
We have a new question.
All right, I feel like
stand up if you could.
What's
So I think, can I answer? Okay, yeah. So I think in order to start a company, I think the ability to deal with failure and the ability to deal with rejection is something that you absolutely have to get over, and you cannot be afraid of it. And you actually have to, what I thought about, because I was very afraid of failure and rejection. It was one of the hurdles I had to overcome. And I said, I want to be happy when I fail, or I want to be happy when I get rejected, because it means I'm actually doing something versus the people that are too scared to not do something. Like, at least I'm actually going out there and putting myself out there and doing it. And I thought that was better than just being the person that didn't even try.
Can you repeat that last part that you just said?
What?
I just zoned out for a second.
Oh my God.
I just thought it was, there's a Teddy Roosevelt quote about this, and I think it's like something that is like a really inspirational quote, and I read it to myself sometimes, because it's like, you don't want to, it's like about being in an arena, and you don't want to be those cold and timid souls that know neither victory nor defeat. And I never wanted to be one of those cold and timid souls.
But now, one of you talked about it being a numbers game too.
Yeah. Actually, the saying around every no is statistically closer to a yes is one of my favorites, because I know it's true. I'm an econ major, and I'm really love math, so I know for sure that's true, and I know that each rejection is an opportunity to really learn from it. Like, even if somebody says your idea is terrible, your market is terrible, everything's terrible. Sorry, what?
Go ahead.
You want me to repeat? No. So you gotta really learn from it and have the discipline to do so, even if your knee-jerk reaction is, oh, this guy doesn't know what he's talking about. Well, maybe he does, right? So there's something to pick up from it and hone it in.
You guys could also send text messages, I guess, up there. But I'm going to call this lady back in the back row. So the question is, do you think that you could be a better leader because you access that feminine part of yourself, I guess maybe with more empathy, potentially? So we kind of talked about this. Who wants to take it?
I think you actually become more aware because you have to overcome so many more prejudices than your male counterparts. You naturally just become more in tune with people's concerns. And so actually there's a joke in our company. So one of my teammates came up to me and was like, yeah, if you want somebody to understand you and come with a solution, go to Nancy. If you want somebody to make you feel really bad about your problem, go to Alex, my COO and co-founder. Oh. It's kind of funny, you know, because I think I approach it with, and with the rest of, I guess, the female team leaders, we all have been through obstacles where we were not heard or we were not given the time. So because of that, we make sure that we don't do the same for our own teammates.
Yet. And Lisa, didn't you have a thought on that? Where you're expected to be sort of the...
I'm probably not the best person to answer this just because...
Right.
I don't really feel like I'm that way.
Okay. Yeah. And I think that's fair, right? Okay, now I want to get that guy in the blue back there.
I would say, actually, for the minority founders to start businesses, don't question yourself. Spend less time asking people and trying to get validation for it, and actually just go out and build it.
I agree 100%. That's exactly what I was going to say. Because I was going to say...
I'm glad. Great minds think alike.
I was going to say that, yeah. Because I think it's just like, you can't look for validation. You just... So, like, I mean, I graduated from Stanford, and I look at my friends that started companies, and all, like, about, you know, a dozen started companies, and they're all men. And I'm like, well, it doesn't... To start a company, all you got to do is try. You don't have, like, there's no one saying, like, you can't start a company. You just got to try. And some of them have been successful and some of them haven't. But for some reason,
yeah,
the women I went to school
awful.
weren't
and
doing it.
And this is Stanford.
Yeah.
It's kind
this
of
is, right. It didn't insane. Make no sense to me. So I didn't understand. So I did it, but...
I'm really impressed by the use of your word napkin, which I think is really good. We have a video on our website called Napkin, and it was basically about showing that the idea goes from kind of abstract and on a napkin to reality, which is real wireframes and real product. And I think one of the things to actually get there, so research is so important. You got to understand your market so well. You have to understand every piece of not only your user, but also of your technology, and also of why someone would be using it and what value you're actually creating. And if you ever a really good understanding of that, that will propel you into kind of the next steps. So for us, that was one, that was very important. We surrounded ourselves with advisors who had kind of been there and done that in every piece of a world that kind of related to what we were doing. And when you surround yourselves with those people, you can learn so much from that. So you really have to understand what you're doing and why you're doing it. And I think, so that's the key, right? Which is like, I could talk to a bunch of people, but how do I filter out? And that's something I think over time we'll get better and better at, differentiating people who kind of speak to something versus people who are actually doing something. So to me, one of the things that as a company, as we interview and as we grow, not just our investor base and our advisor base and all of that, we look for people who want to solve this problem. And you know, you can be an engineer who doesn't want to solve this problem, and you're probably not the best fit for our team because this stuff is hard. It's not easy. You're not going to be done, you know, in a week or 2 weeks or sometimes a year or 2 years. It takes time, and you have to follow through it. And so that's why it's so important to find people who actually care about solving it, because those are the ones that often do. And that's what I would say. That's what you have to look for in people. What do they believe in, and why are they working on what they're working on?
Okay, we have a lot of people want to ask some questions. So I'm going to go. So the question is, if you had freshmen or sophomore women in college, in high school, oh, better yet, okay, what should we be doing as parents, friends, uncles, nieces, aunts?
I would be asking people for advice. I think the hardest thing to do is to ask someone for help, but that's where you're gonna get the best resources and get the most enriching answers and help. So the more you can ask for people, if you ask your parents, like who do you know in your network that knows this, and you can find things that you're passionate about, you can connect to other people that you're passionate about, but you have to ask. And I think that's the hardest part for me when I was in high school would be just to ask someone, this is something I'm passionate about, do you know anyone that can help me? Because that's a big, you don't wanna put yourself out there for that rejection. But I think that's where it's gonna be the most enriching experience.
Here's what I do for my 12-year-old sister. So I have a 12-year-old sister who is in seventh grade, and I just want her, it's not so much I want her to be an entrepreneur, but I think there's so many other skills you learn by being entrepreneurial. And what she was passionate about is in the environment. So I said, all right, go and write like a 2-page business proposal about how you would start a school garden at your school and give it to your principal. And so I helped her write it out. It was 2-page. And I said, you're going to give it to your principal, gave it to the principal. And then in the background, I was also emailing with the principal to say, hey, are you already doing this? And then sure enough, she was like, yeah. The principal was like, yeah, let's go do this. And then we went to a local bank and got the local bank to sponsor the school garden for $6,000 and build like a very small school garden.
So if I was 15 or 16, what I would tell a 15, 16-year-old that wants to start a company, is that your question? I would tell them just to start.
Just do it. You learn from
just
doing it.
Just to do it.
And you're start taking selling. The right step.
So everyone, yeah. Like sales to me is really important. Yeah, and like start actually, like everyone speaks from their own experience, so, and gives advice based on their own experience, but this is also what I did, so maybe it doesn't apply, but I started selling it before we even created it, so I made sure. So I think sales is really key. So I'd say start working on the different projects, and then also start selling.
I think
don't be afraid to sell stuff.
I think as adults, it would be really nice if I were a 15-year-old girl, if we had coding classes, like where we can actually like learn what it is about.
Demystify the coding.
Yeah, I had no idea what that was until I started the company. So.
Okay, more questions.
Yes.
What is your goal for 2015?
Just one?
Just 10x our revenues.
There you go.
For us, it's actually scaling an amazing team, and that's something that, you know, was our goal very early on at 5 people, goal at 10 people, now, at 20 people, and scaling a great team is one of the hardest things to do, and we've talked about this a little bit earlier, but that's a big goal of ours, okay. In addition to building value.
Goal for 2015.
I don't talk about my goals.
Wow, okay. Mystery. Woman of mystery over here. Okay, let me get to some more questions.
Sorry.
Yeah, so I guess we commented that women get less time to make that first impression, so then what should we be doing to make sure we make use of the time we do have?
I would say control the conversation. If you're pitching to a VC, they've heard your company probably hundreds of times already, but they haven't heard it from you. So make sure that they're not controlling the conversation, but you are.
Well, I think
can you share your goals, please?
Private question. Sorry, I can't answer that.
No,
go ahead. Go ahead.
The question was.
Yeah, you have a first impression.
I think VCs, they want to see someone that's strong, and they want to see someone that's a go-getter and that can fight on obstacles. So they want to see your personality, and don't be afraid to show that. And they want to see someone that, you know, that is going to give them confidence.
Oh yeah, if you could go back and do something different, time warp, what would you do?
I would learn how to code if I were 15 years old. At least I would be able to understand better what our engineers are saying.
Sure.
I think that will help me. Yeah.
Two things that I would change, one is on the personal side, one is business related. Personal side, I wish I started earlier. I started in college, but I wish I started in high school. The related to team thing, there was somebody on our team that stayed on probably longer than we should have let that person stay on, but we just couldn't get ourselves to like let them go. And instead, it's like we should have just, you know, it's hire slowly, fire fast. I didn't learn that until later on. So that.
Okay, so the question is, the importance of research, and when do you get to the point that you feel confident about putting out the product that you have? Or raising money, or, you know, when do you think you're ready?
So I think the research is really important, right? To know that if what you're creating or what your vision is, is it actually going to have an impact once it's out there? So we quickly realized that yes, it will. I mean, 12.5 billion man hours are spent on one, you know, social network alone. So you can imagine how many hours are spent on communications, you know, every day and every year. So the need for our solution, I think, became pretty obvious in the research that we actually did. And I think the minute you should start your company is the minute you are willing to take someone else's capital to fund it. And we value others' capital more than you even value your own. You know, you're a custodian for someone else's, you know, funds, right? So it's really important that you trust yourself just as much as they're going to trust you when they fund you. So to me, that's the moment. When you're confident, when you know what you're building, you know what you're going after, and your goals are very well defined in that process, I think that's when you should start. So a lot of that comes from your own self-confidence, and it also comes from your research and what you're actually creating and what kind of value you actually want to bring to the world. And I'm a big fan of courageous innovation, so like innovating things for the sake of innovating things isn't as exciting to me as innovating things that should be there but just aren't. Entefy was one such thing, and we saw that as a really big opportunity. And we knew when we were ready to take capital, that's when we knew, because we had the confidence that it was going to have an impact.
I'm always really impressed by people that can pull that off. I knew that I was not going to be able to pull that off. So I always knew that, like, for us to raise capital, that we would have to, because I was a first-time entrepreneur, that I would have to create when we were doing our Series A, you know, I'd have to create a product and then actually sell it so I could prove revenue. And then I had those results to then take. Mm-hmm. To the VC, but mm-hmm. I'm always very impressed by people that are able to do it.
So the question is, how important sales? Well, we've talked about sales a bit. How important do you think sales is, and what have you learned through the sales process?
Well, it's core. It's so important. It's like every minute of your like work. One thing I learned in terms of like sales is like your mood really, really like matters a lot. So one time, so like when we were doing something really sales heavy, what I would do is like if I'm not in a good mood, I postpone that meeting, or I go back into a room and I meditate and I come out happy, and that's the only way I can sell.
Yeah, it's sort of like your charge song, you know, it's like get in the right mood. Okay,
passion.
Well, we're almost done. Any dying questions? Who's dying the most for the question? Jump up and down or do something. Okay, all right.
It's interesting because I think I also have multiple sides of my personality where I I will wear dresses and at other times I will not. And I think I more of just like I adapt to different things. And I don't know what would have happened to certain meetings had I just like dress the same way. I'm not sure. I don't know if I have enough data points to pinpoint that.
Yeah, I think this is a good question.
So I wrote a blog when I was thinking about starting a company, and it was just basically like inspirational quotes that I thought were inspiration, and I just copied and pasted. And so like, I don't know, it really helps me because I go back to that blog and I remember like why I'm doing this. Also, point, side point, but I met my co-founder off that blog that I wrote.
Nice. So there you go.
He's been a great co-founder, so.
Right.
And I'd also say look how far you've come, because no matter what, if you've been like a week or a month, if you look back to when you just started or look back a week ago, you've come so far in that week that it re-energizes me every time.
Half full instead of half empty, absolutely. Yeah.
I love what Lisa said about quotes. It's actually amazing how a single quote can sometimes motivate you. So one of the quotes that really has stuck with me for the past several years is the quote, "You are the average of the five people you spend the most time with." Oh. And so a lot of people, after hearing that, they're like, damn, I need to get new friends. but it's really true. If you surround yourself with amazing, awesome, supportive people that are also entrepreneurial, then that builds you up. So the people I spend time with, I spend a lot of time with my investors who are successful entrepreneurs themselves, and they motivate me. And even, you know, my friends are like, oh, aren't you so excited that you hit that milestone? I'm like, no, because like I listen to my investor, they're like, yeah, I remember when I made my first 100 million, you know, things like that. Where it really, that is motivating.
I agree with that.
Yeah. Okay, just a couple more. Okay. Oh yeah, company names. This can be interesting. And how many of you? Let me ask you. Have you all changed your names? No, you're still with the first ones.
We changed the spelling of our name, but the word Entefy, it's originally spelled Entify, and it's actually an old British term, and it means to materialize, so to bring something to life. And we loved it. We just when you see it, like you just we loved it, and we spelled it Entify, which looked too rigid, like in text, we people mispronounced it, Entefy, and it was just terrible. So we changed it to a Y at the end, and we think that it really kind of embodies what we're trying to do, which
and
is why we love it.
And you got the URL right away?
Yeah, we didn't get the one with the Entify, the original spelling, but we have our okay. Entefy.
Okay, anybody else have a name story?
For us, I just came up with a bunch of those, and then I just ran a Google survey and just asked them which one you like, and then this one won, so it took us like a couple days.
Mine was definitely following, so for Natalie Bioscience, there was a trend in like 2011 where everyone was doing like LY at the end of like their startup name, so we were working with nanoparticles, so I was like, Nano Lee, and the URL was available, so that worked out.
Okay.
And when you're building a company, like, especially in the early days, it's like all about survival. So you're like, well, if I procrastinate, I won't survive. That's how I dealt with it.
Making payroll is a good motivator.
Yeah, that's true. I'm missing the check.
I have an engineering co-founder, and he always tells me, like, we can finish this in 2 days. And it's been pretty obvious that like whenever it's 2 days and you multiply that by five times, so that's how I work with him. And like he knows that too.
And how the product turns out to be okay, or else you wouldn't be putting up with that, I'm sure.
Yeah. It's like as long as you know how to work with that, I think it's you get used to it.
Yeah. Well, I think we're getting close to wrap up. Any words of inspiration that you'd like some 15-year-olds or 10-year-olds to think about.
Do what you're passionate about.
Yeah.
If you're passionate about it, you keep going no matter what. If it's starting a company, if it's working for a great company, whatever it is, do it, and then everything else falls into place around that.
Sometimes, like, fear really discourages you from doing what you really want to do. So the question that I ask myself when I'm trying to figure out, like, am I not doing this because I'm afraid, or am I not doing this because it's just not worth it? What if I wasn't afraid, what would I do? Like, if I wasn't afraid of failing, what would I do?
Oh, I used to tell some of the companies I advise, say, if you were a guy, what would you do? And sometimes that changes the framing just a little
That's
bit.
That's funny.
Nancy, do you have anything?
Everything comes down to being about people with your business. Work with people that you admire, work with people that are smarter than you, work with people that you can see being with you 10 years down the road and that you still want to work with 10 years down the road.
Did everybody go? Yeah?
You too? Do you want to go next?
I'd echo what she said.
Oh, the passion? Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to say absolutely do what you love. And I always think actually about if this is my last day, you know, would I be doing the same thing? And I know I'm doing the right thing when the answer is yes.
Great. So. Well, it's my privilege to have gotten to know you guys. And I'm sure the audience feels the same way. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.